me first start off by asking you, how many of you actually have read the chapter one? And be honest. Okay, so Thomas, would you like to pass
Yep.
out the quiz?
I'm gonna start with the quiz.
So we'll start with the quiz.
Okay.
Jokes aside, let's talk about the five most important things of chapter one. So first of all, we have expand your reach. Second, we go on to consider knowledge and expectations. Fourth, empathize with their personalities. Determine any bias. And then at the end, get the audience on your side, which clearly I didn't. And the whole basis of the chapter one is over audience analysis. So now I will discuss about expanding your reach. So the strategy framework works as AIM, as we know it. AIM is audience, intent, and message. So audience is you guys, crowd, people in your life, family, friends, boyfriend, girlfriend, shareholders, buyers, managers, all of that is your audience. So whoever you're going to be talking to is going to be an audience, which will be listening to the intent that of your message. So why, how, where, when. And the intent is one of the most important parts, in my opinion, because if you don't have the right intent for your audience won't understand what you're trying to say, which goes, which leads on to message. So, excuse me, what was that you were trying to say? If your audience doesn't understand what you're trying to say, then both your intent and your message is killed. So it all goes hand in hand because if you understand your audience, you can tailor your intent to that, and if you understand your intentions, then your message is going to be completely exclusive to your audience. So expand your reach. Who are they? They being the audience. Audience being you. So who are you guys? You guys are students, business students, some marketing, some finance, some from different cultures, different religions, etc. So you have to be the insider on the primary audience, which is you guys. So the primary audience includes everybody that is in the presentation, not outside, excluding everyone outside. So basically anyone that's going to see this video is going to be a secondary audience. And so how it works is that you have to be the insider, knowing all the data of the group that you're going to be presenting to, and understanding how to use that group data to assess the audience. And so once you're the insider, you know what to do, and if you're not the insider, if you have no knowledge of the audience, what you would have to do is talk to people. So in my case, as I'm doing a presentation to a class, I would talk to the professor. I would talk to some of the students I've talked to and introduce myself to. And I would assess that, with that information, I would assess the audience. Now, going to secondary audience, how that would work is basically everybody outside of this presentation will be the secondary audience. So how do you reach the secondary audience? Well, as you see the picture, I put Damn Daniel. So what does that mean? What is Damn Daniel? Okay, so Damn Daniel is a young boy from, young man, I guess you can say, from Riverside High School in California that had his friend videotape him coming with white Vans in just outside setting. So why would that be a good example of secondary audience? Because initially, the friend posted it for his friends, which was the primary audience. And then it became viral, which became the secondary audience with the use of social media, which happens to be Snapchat in this case, which is the filter. And so now there's the Axe company, Clorox, and Vans company, which have made advertisings according to this. There has been remixes made from the Damn Daniel little voice memo. And so that's a prime example of secondary audience expansion, which goes back to the fact of expanding your reach. Another way you can do it, so we said social media. There's another way you can do it is by asking the classroom. So in the case of Comet, the career expo, the professor asked you to share the information, which would basically expand that outside the audience. And then one more thing, actually, there is the fact that you can survey, you can hand out a survey. So if I were to hand you out a handout so you can understand the matter at hand, and then you can go talk to your friends about the handout. So, oh my God, this handout was good, so much information, thank you so much for giving me this handout, yada, yada, yada. Now moving on to Jason.
Our next big point is consider the knowledge and expectations of your audience. Let's first consider your knowledge. You want to identify beginners and experts within the crowd. How you do this, you can do a survey, as Kaiser mentioned, or you can speak to your audience members individually, you know, as they come in. Or there are plenty of other methods. You could also gauge your audience as you're speaking to them. And you want to cater your message to these beginners and to the experts. Cater to the beginners. You want to identify any jargon in your speech. How you can do this, you can have an initial slide on your presentation that'll go over any acronyms or industry-specific terms. What I mean by this is if you're given a presentation on finance, you may want to explain that WACC is weighted average cost of capital. Or if you're giving a presentation on the financial crisis of 2008, you might want to describe what a collateralized debt obligation is. Another way is including the experts. And how you can do this is try to get them involved in the presentation. Ask questions. Have them have their input in many things like that. Once you identify the experts, beginners, you identify jargon, you know their knowledge, you want to gauge their expectations. And their expectations, many other factors. The biggest one you want to identify is the time limit. How long do they expect you to be speaking? Is it a 10-minute presentation, or is it an hour long? You can modify your content to match either one. You also want to look at the formality of the presentation. Are you going to speak in a setting like this where you want to go professional? Or maybe you can do khakis and a button-up shirt. You want to consider that. Thirdly, this refers back to the beginners and experts. You want to think about the content. What kind of content is your audience looking for? And how you do this is gauge the audience. Beginners, you may have more surface level material that just kind of scratch the surface. Or with experts, you might get a little bit more in depth into a major topic, and you need a much more involved discussion with the experts. The last and final thing you want to do is assess any cultural challenges. And I'll talk about this with an example. Let's say you're in New York City, you're doing a presentation. Say you're in Chinatown, you may want to do a red color scheme because red symbolizes joy, happiness, positive emotions like this, and that'd be great to include in a presentation. Say you go down to Wall Street from there, you have a similar presentation. You don't want that red color scheme because that's going to evoke negative emotions. So this just kind of leads back to knowing your audience, finding out what they already know, what they expect to hear, and if there are any cultural challenges. And I'm going to pass over to Thomas.
All right, so we talked about what your audience knows and what their interests are, sort of. About how they feel. So that's something that we probably did up here without even realizing it as we started our presentation. We looked around, and if everyone was already looking at us and extremely engaged and they were just ready to learn, then we definitely have a different presentation style and a few more different tactics than we would if everyone already had their arms crossed and were looking on their phone. So gauging their emotions and understanding how your audience feels. How do you do that? I already talked about that a little bit with your arms crossed, so body language. That's a huge giveaway. Situations like this where people are taking notes, it's going to be a little bit different, but body language is going to be one of your best friends whenever you're trying to read how your audience is feeling. Build on the positives. So we've already seen a few presentations this semester with topics that are a little bit more controversial than what we're talking about today, but if you're having a lot of negative responses to whatever you might be covering, the moment you have a positive response to something, you want to build on that. So either continue to keep them engaged and narrow their focus even more, or add another story, make some more humor, whatever it is that's getting your audience interested in you, you want to continue with that and build on it. Assessing their interests. So you have to figure out what your audience is interested in. Are they even interested in what we're going to be talking about? I'm not sure today, but so if you have a bored audience, you want to hook them. I just did a little joke like that. You guys laugh. Maybe you're paying a little bit more attention right now. So there's something you can do if your audience seems like they're not interested. They seem like they're bored. And if they're already interested in it, you can involve them. You can ask a question where people are free to respond, make it more of a setting where we're in a conversation and we're engaged. bias. This is I chose this picture for a number of reasons, not just because their faces are funny, but so determine any bias. So I'm sure we're all going to see a lot with these presidential candidates in the coming months that we've already seen, of them giving these great presentations and these speeches across the country. Do you really think that they're going to say the same thing in California that we're going to hear in Texas? I severely doubt it. So this Friday, Marco Rubio is actually going to be in Dallas, and I'm sure whatever he says this Friday is going to be much different than what he says the next Friday. But evaluate your objective. So what do these politicians, what do the presenters want your audience to know? If we're trying to get you to change all of your opinions and grasp this really broad concept, we're probably not going to succeed just because that's a really hard task to do with the presentation. You should simplify any issues that might be complicated. Just as some of these candidates have done a great job, some of them haven't. I still don't know what some of the issues they are that we're talking about, but if they can do something to simplify it to where even the people who are beginners, as we talked about, can understand, that's going to help your audience as a whole. Analyzing their bias, of course there's going to be people with different opinions. So you want to not just try to strike them down, but acknowledge that there are opposing views to whatever you're talking about. If the audience sees that you acknowledge their standpoint, even though it's not what you have, they might have a little bit more of a positive outlook on your presentation and talk about it and say, well, although they talked about this, they at least acknowledged that you know, my side was there and that made me feel better. So appeal to and influence negative bias. Like I said, really don't get your hopes too high on this one, because people are going to have different opinions and biases coming into your presentation. Not everyone's going to leave a changed person. So keep that in mind, and with that I'm going to pass off.
Alright, so now it's important to get the audience on your side, because it's extremely difficult to talk to an audience that has a negative perception of you. So I know we've all seen at least a few TED Talks in the past 6 months or so, but they're a great way to, you know, learn how to give a good presentation. They use appeals very well, and I'm also going to use an example of a specific TED Talk. So Scott Frazier is a forensic psychologist, and he worked on a murder case where somebody was at the scene of a crime and he was convicted of murder and was sentenced to life in prison. So he believed he was innocent, and he set out to prove it. So he went out and reenacted the entire crime with the permission of the judge and showed him that, you know, eyewitness testimony can be extremely unreliable. But what that does is it's a double-edged appeal to logic and emotion. You know, this guy was a father. He was in jail long enough for his son to grow all the way up and become a college student. And he was actually released, too. That's the more astonishing part. If you're interested, you can look up his name and the TED Talk will come up. But that just takes us back to appeals. So there's three major types of appeals. There's emotional appeals, logical appeals, and personal appeals. You might know them as ethos, pathos, and logos. But they all appeal to different parts of what, you know, what makes us human. Under emotional appeals, and again, they're not specific. You know, you can file different things under different appeals. But benchmarking is a type of appeal where you compare your group to another group and try to do better or try to do less than they are, depending on what you're comparing yourself with. And benchmarking is most effective when comparing your business to smaller groups. So keep that in mind. And you can also request adjustments, which, like the presidential candidates Thomas talked about, they're, you know, asking for something different. There's another saying called WIFM. It's not a radio station. It stands for What's in It for Me. It's a great way to get the audience on your side, because you're trying to make it about them. You're trying to benefit them. And another thing is you want to exude earnestness and goodwill. You want to be a good presenter in that way. So. And that's a good audience right there. You also want to appear credible. You don't want to show up to a presentation in a t-shirt and jeans like this. You want to look good. You want to stay in touch with your audience, and you want to stay in touch with the experts in your audience. As we've talked about before, if you go to a convention of engineers and start talking about simple engineering 101 sort of stuff with them, they're not going to be very engaged in your presentation. So you want to stay in touch with your audience and keep their interests at heart as you make a presentation. You want to look professional, you want to sound good, dress well, and just look great in general. It'll make you appear more credible. And finally, you want to seek common ground with your audience. For example, if you're a presidential candidate speaking to people in a state where most people might not agree with you, it's important to try and temper your message so you're not alienating